Before Hurricane Hugo slammed into the South Carolina coast in September 1989, many people did not believe such a storm could happen. It had been 30 years since the last significant hurricane affected the Charleston area, Hurricane Gracie in 1959. And even though Hugo is classified a Category 4 storm on the Saffir-Simpson hurricane wind scale, the entire Charleston area did not experience such conditions, particularly those south of the peninsula.
Don't count on your experiences with Hugo unless you were in McClellanville, and then you understand.
Please do not think the next time we have a major storm come here that you went through a major storm already.
Had that strongest part of the hurricane moved over Charleston, which only would have required a small change of course on the part of the storm, it would have pushed a much higher storm surge up into the Charleston Harbor and would have inundated significant sections of town.
Hurricane Hugo was by no means a worst case scenario for Charleston. If it had been farther to the south, areas along the Battery, downtown Charleston, the Wando River, Cooper River, West Ashley, Mount Pleasant, all these areas would have been inundated. And so by having the storm make landfall farther to north, it was actually a saving grace for Charleston. Could have been much worse.
Although there has been significant infrastructure and population growth along the South Carolina coast since Hugo struck, there has also been an improvement in hurricane forecasts as well as communication methods, particularly regarding storm surge, which is the biggest threat to life from hurricanes. But what exactly is storm surge, and why should people in this part of the country care about this hazard?
The storm surge is just an abnormal rise in water over and above the predicted tide. Now, the storm surge doesn't include tides, it doesn't include waves, it doesn't include the freshwater flooding. All of that combined would be the total water rise or the inundation that you might see along the coast.
The storm surge is dependent upon so many different variables with regard to the storm. The storm's forward speed, the size of it, the landfall location, all these play a major factor in how we forecast storm surge. One storm is completely different than the next. They each have their own characteristics. And so, you know, when you get residents saying, well, I remember the last Cat 4 and this is where we had the largest amount of inundation or storm surge, that does not necessarily apply to future storms.
Charleston area and really coastal South Carolina, the reason it's so vulnerable to storm surge is because of the coastal geography. Because the continental shelf is very shallow, and that allows the water to push very far inland. And on top of that, you have bays, you have estuaries, and that too can funnel the water up along the coast. The storm surge threat can extend for 10 or 20, even 30 miles inland. And for those people that live that far inland, they may think that we're not at risk for the coastal storm surge threat. We may be at risk for the wind threat or the tornado threat, but not the water threat that we might see along the coast, the immediate coast.
People just don't know what surge is. They don't understand it. They can't fathom how quickly water can rise. They don't understand how important it is to be out of that surge zone. I mean, they threaten their life and other people's lives, first responders' lives, if they're in that surge zone. So it's so important that they evacuate.
If the emergency officials say, be ready to evacuate or evacuate, do so. And be prepared in advance. Know where you're going. If it's a relative or you know your routes, be prepared, go. It's a pain in the neck to evacuate. It's a lot better than being dead. When the word goes out to evacuate, do so.
Of course, storm surge is only one of the hazards associated with hurricanes. Strong winds are also typical, with tornadoes and flooding rains possible.
We know that surge is the deadliest part of a hurricane, but there are an awful lot of hazards that are also associated with hurricanes. In fact, hurricanes are defined by their wind speed. Hurricanes can cause wind speeds anywhere from 75 miles per hour in a minimal hurricane, all the way up to over 150 miles per hour when we get to Category 4 and 5. Some of the other threats that we can see from hurricanes are tornadoes. In fact, tornadoes can produce well ahead of the storm in the outer bands. Finally, inland flooding can also be a threat, especially when it gets into the mountainous terrain.
The mission of the National Weather Service is to protect lives and property, and we have recently started an initiative to help build a weather-ready nation. So what exactly does this mean?
Well, building a weather-ready nation is building a community that's ready, responsive, and resilient to the increasing hazards associated with extreme events, whether they be floods, droughts, hurricanes, blizzards, heat waves, cold waves. We have to build this ability to not only forecast these events, but convey the threats and impacts associated with them, work with our partners so that people take the actions that are needed to protect their lives and property.
Being prepared is the biggest thing. That's the name of the game. Well, I'd be remiss in my duties if I did not talk preparedness and preach the word of having that disaster plan and having that supply kit. You have to take responsibility for your own well-being.
In an effort to help people become weather ready, the National Weather Service will be rolling out new products and services, particularly for the deadly storm surge, to help people better understand and appreciate their risk of inundation from the surge.
I think the changes that are being proposed by the Weather Service, some of these new products that we're going to get that might show the threat graphically, would help the public to better understand, to better realize the threat they might face.
This is the inundation graphic. It'll be experimental for the 2014 hurricane season. And what it is just a color depiction showing areas of the greatest threat for inundation.
The forecasts that we get from the Weather Service, from the National Hurricane Center, have been outstanding the past few years. But it's communicating the threat and the impact to those that live along the coast.
The government has realized how important investing resources into the models and other observation posts and all the kinds of things that you do helps us get the word out. And now we can physically show, here's what we think is going to happen, and we feel pretty confident about that.
Although there are many players involved in helping the National Weather Service develop a weather-ready nation, the media is particularly instrumental since they are the main voice to the public during hazardous weather such as hurricanes. But much has changed over the past 25 years when it comes to the way the broadcast media communicates with the public.
The biggest change is that we do 7 shows a night versus 2 now, plus we're doing radio, plus we're doing Facebook, so we're more distributing content. Severe weather content, we're distributors now rather than just one TV station. The great news is we can get warnings out immediately. We can be immediate and nowcast and see what's going on. The tough part is just to make sure that that people are getting the right information and not the wrong information, and correcting the record on the wrong information.
There's a lot more outlets out there, and our big concern, because we've never had a major disaster with social media in place, is that there is a lot of damage control. There are a lot of fake Photoshop pictures out there, especially after Katrina, big giant tidal waves coming over the area. And so I worry about that being the next time, that we're going to have to do a lot more dispelling rumors as opposed to getting the real information out there.
I really think the job of the media is to distill all of this information that comes in, the very scientific products that we get, and to distill it in a way that the public can understand it, and then they can act on that.
We're all on the same team. We're all trying to protect life and property and get people out of harm's way. So whatever we can do, certainly to promote Weather Ready Nation and forward your message, that's what we're going to do.
Ultimately, being prepared is the best way you can become weather ready.
The good news is we have better modeling. We know the storm's going to be coming. We can get the warnings out, and hopefully people will look at the history and say, you know what, I might not want to be hanging out here when the Cat 3 or 4 hurricane comes our way.
If we do the best job any city's ever done in helping our citizens prepare for a serious hurricane, then the benefits of us knowing we served them, of them knowing that we did, would be enormous.
And the teacher would write an assignment on the board, and at the end of the day, she would erase that because the brand new assignment was on tap for the next day. That's the way it is every hurricane season. We wipe the blackboard clean. We can't say, well, just because we had X hurricane this year, it's going to be another 100 years or 50 years. It could be next year, the year after that, 5 years, 10 years. We just don't know. Prepare as if this is going to be the year every year. So if you get ready in June, you don't have to worry about it in August, September if we do have one.
We hope through these videos you gained an appreciation for the power of these deadly storms and for the importance of being prepared for the next one. Thanks for watching.